I thank the organizers for this excellent meeting that they're organizing every year, giving us the opportunity to present our work. So this is what I'm going to talk about is dynamical quantum phase transition in open systems. And this is basically based on this paper, which is written with Shaubhik, who is in the audience, Sudarsana Laha, Utsho Bhattacharya, and Amit Dutta. And then I go back to the slide I intended to start with, because this paper, the work I am trying to talk about, has a connection with this paper where we defined a new metric for measuring the distance between the density matrices. And I wanted to give you a brief survey of what is a dynamical quantum phase transitions. Okay, very quickly, classical phase transitions are triggered by thermal fluctuations, as we know, we have been hearing here. Quantum phase transition is not yet touched upon, but it is to some extent, it is similar to classical phase transitions, but in this case, it's driven by quantum fluctuations. And usually, whenever we talk about a phase transition, a second order phase transition, we talk about order parameter, we talk about critical exponents. And now question is, can there be such non-analyticities in an effective free energy due to non-equilibrium evolution? People have been taking closed quantum system, subjected them to some quench so that they evolve in a non-equilibrium way, and then ask the question that can I define an effective free energy density, and are there non-analyticities in these effective free energies? As we know, all these phase transitions I am referring to are characterized by non-analyticities in the free energy density or ground state energy density. So non-analyticities are the hallmark of a phase transition. So with this idea in mind, people proposed the concept of dynamical quantum phase transition. Well, the coinage was in this paper, but it was already existing long time back from a paper by Shubroto in IISc and Polman and others. And also we did our part for this low quenching part of the business. So what is the business? Here you start with an initial state, which is psi 0 lambda I. We let it evolve with a Hamiltonian, which is lambda F. You note this is the ground state with a parameter lambda I, whereas the Hamiltonian has a parameter lambda F. You look at something called loss-mitt overlap, or it is known as rate function of the return probability. That is the overlap between the evolved state and the initial state. You are asked the question, how much of the initial state is still remaining in your evolved state? And look at the non-analyticities. Whenever this quantity vanishes, that means evolved state is orthogonal to the initial state we've started with. I call it a dynamical phase transitions in the sense that rate function of return probability, which I have defined here, IT, this quantity shows a cusp singularity. So this is called a dynamical phase transition. People still don't know whether there is something called dynamical universality class. So to elaborate this, I take this simplest paradigmatic model, transversizing model, which is exactly solvable. It has two non-commuting terms, and that's why it shows a quantum phase transition. If you change this transverse field term, what is to be noted that sigma x and sigma j do not commute. So it is truly a quantum Hamiltonian, even at t is equal to zero. But tuning this field, you can go from a ferromagnetically ordered phase to a paramagnetic ordered phase. This model is important because it is integrable, and you can do everything of this model in terms of 2x2 matrices for each momentum mode. So this is the simplest form, and you can calculate the rate function of return probability, which I defined for you, which is nothing but the overlap of the evolved state with the initial state, but it gets decoupled into different momentum modes because of the underlying 2x2 nature of this model. So what do you see? So what you do, you take a transversizing model with an initial field HI, maybe it was in the ferromagnetic phase, you suddenly change the field so that it goes to paramagnetic phase. So you have a state which was a ground state, ferromagnetic state, evolving with a Hamiltonian which belongs to the paramagnetic Hamiltonian. And now look for this rate function of the return probability. You see sharp non-analyticities occurring at different instants on time. These are the points of dynamical quantum critical point, if you like. And you can, in this model, you can exactly analytically calculate where do these analyticities occur. So non-analyticities are dynamical quantum phase transition, and you can define this an effective partition function, which is nothing but the loss-mitt overlap, and you can show fast derivative of the free energy is discontinuous here. These are really cusp singularities. So this is more or less well established. One can talk about a topological order parameter. which can be constructed out of this lost bit overlap, and that shows a quantized jump at every dynamical quantum critical point. So dynamical quantum phase transition, if I summarize, start with a state which is some quantum state psi zero, evolve with some different Hamiltonian at some, after some instant of time, take the overlap with the initial state you start with, see whether the state vanishes, and then the log of that quantity gives you non-analyticities. Those non-analyticities I am calling dynamical phase transitions. But this dynamics, what I have been talking about, is entirely unitary. It is evolving with a Hamiltonian. So unitary matrix is e to the power I h t. As simple as that. The question then comes, can I have such non-analyticities in open system? Why open system is problematic? Open system would be problematic because dynamics is no longer unitary. The story doesn't end here. So first problem is that dynamics is not unitary. So you don't expect that simply you start with a psi, evolve with e to the power I h t and take the overlap with psi. What you have to work with? You have to work with non-analyticities in distance in density matrices. So for an open system, you must go to the density matrix and you have to have a finite temperature counterpart of the loss mitt overlap. Let me remind you, what was the loss mitt overlap? Loss mitt overlap was given by this quantity simply, which is a metric. You must be able to define a metric in the density matrix space which satisfies all the properties of a metric. So that's the question I have asked. How do you define a finite temperature counterpart of the loss mitt overlap that reduces to zero temperature situation? So this is the main theme of the work. So we have realized that now there is no unique generalization of the loss mitt overlap. The simple overlap, I said, evolved state with the initial state in terms of density matrix. There are four ways. One comes from the work statistics, which I didn't mention, that the quantity I rate function of the return probability is actually related to the amount of work done. In quantum mechanics, work is not an observable, so you do it in terms of two time correlation functions. So one is from work statistics, another is from the Ullman phase approach, and another is from fidelity, which where you measure the distance between two density matrices. All of them reduce to the zero temperature situation. But what we brought in the business is something called interferometric phase approach. What is that? That's it. Idea is that you have ancillaries. So if you go this way, you have a composite system A and B. Then you trace out B, usually you get a systems are entangled and you get a mixed state for A. It's the other way around. So you have a mixed state A, you add ancillaries and construct a bigger Hilbert space in which it's a pure state. And if you trace out your ancillary, you get back your initial density matrix. Here, I'm starting with an initial density matrix, and then I construct a pure state by adding ancillaries. And this is my corresponding loss mitt overlap. And you can check, if you set temperature goes to zero, it goes to the simple expression I gave you in the beginning. So point was first to construct a measure, a metric that measures the distance in the density matrix space, and then whether density matrices vanishes, this distance vanishes, then I will get non-analyticities. So model is again transversizing model at a finite open quantum system. So you quench from HI to HF, and then I choose a Lidmaldian operator. This is also the second problem in the business. We choose it in such a way it is local in so-called Jordan-Wigner fermions, so that I can write the Lindbergh-Mastad equation, and it is within the Markovian approximation. So within the Markovian approximation, we solve this density matrix, and fortunately for this model, for this type of dissipator, we can do exactly analytically everything. We can find out the density matrix. We can find out the measure which I have defined here in terms of the purifications, and then what I find out that if it is your initial state, okay, I saw it on a block sphere. If it is on initial state, you do some dissipative dynamics following a quench. You change the field, let its system evolve under a dissipative environment. It goes first to a steady state. Markovian dynamics guarantees you reach a steady state. Then you do a further quench. You reach the second steady state. In between, you find a non-analyticity. So here, this is initial evolves density matrix is completely opposite to the orthogonal to the initial density matrix I started with, and you can immediately find out that there are non-analyticities present. So point is, since Adip is already up there, point is that PR state, unitary dynamics, start from a state, evolve with a different Hamiltonian, look for how much of the initial state was still remaining in the evolved state, you may say, see non-analyticities where they become orthogonal. But if you do an open system, you have twofold problems. Firstly, dynamics not unitary, and what is the measure that reduces to the pure state overlap? We managed to find out both. For a particular dissipator, we could solve the Lindwald equation, and we could find out, yes, there could be a situation in going from one steady state to other where you get these non-analyticities. So these non-analyticities may persist even in open quantum systems with non-unitary dynamics. Okay, thank you very much.
Questions?
Yes.
It's not unique, but no. It is, incidentally, it's not unique. There is a U1 gauge freedom you have, this interferometric approach. In the Ullmann approach, you have UN gauge freedom, and then you could do the parallel transport. But here, the quantity here, which you are essentially measuring, okay, that is the loss bit overlap. I is for interferometric phase. That is independent of the ancillary you choose. So wherever, whatever ancillary you choose, okay, the result will survive.
Any other question?
Good. So, okay. Thank you.